We're delighted tonight to have with us Elizabeth Dowling Taylor, the New York Times bestselling author of A Slave in the White House. She's here tonight to read from and discuss her new book, The Original Black Elite, an outstanding cultural biography of Black history pioneer Daniel Murray. This brilliantly researched new book chronicles a critical yet overlooked chapter in American history, the inspiring rise and calculated fall of the Black elite, Black politicos and professionals from Emancipation through Reconstruction to the Jim Crow era in the nation's capital. This riveting and timely story reminds us all how fragile racial progress has been in American history. And as Khalil Gibran Muhammad has said of this new book, it is about the need to vigilantly learn from the past and to never forget that Black progress has always been met with resistance and erasure. We hope you'll join me in welcoming Elizabeth Dowling Taylor tonight. And before that, I would like you to welcome Gregory Lopez Bondi, a descendant of Daniel Murray, his great-great-grandson. Okay, I was going to add another great. His great-great-grandson. So thank you very much, Gregory.
Hi, good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure for both my family and I to be here today. My name is Gregory Lopez Bondi, and over there is my grandmother, Mari Carmen Murray, Daniel and Anna's granddaughter. So, about 3 years ago in high school, I was assigned to do a project on my family history. I didn't know much about my ancestors, so I decided to ask my parents if I had any famous relatives I could talk about. Initially, I went to my dad, and he said that he had an uncle who was canonized as a saint, but I decided to go a different direction. So, afterwards, I went to my mom, and imagine my surprise when she told me to Google Daniel Murray and Anna Evans. When I pulled up the Wikipedia pages, I was astonished, and I learned two new facts. One, my great-great-grandparents were African-Americans. And second, they were prominent figures in Washington, D.C. during the era of Reconstruction. Through interviews with my grandmother and also my own personal research, my family and I came to understand their contributions in the District of Columbia and their fight for education and justice. After our presentation, my sister and I even became so engrossed that we created an Ancestry.com account to find out more. A few months later, I was doing what most teenagers do on their free time, checking Facebook. When I was going through my newsfeed, I received a strange message from a mysterious woman named Beth Taylor. The message read, "Dear Gregory, I saw that you have an Ancestry.com account, and I wanted to contact you about your family history. I am currently researching Harold Baldwin Murray for a book I'm writing. Please contact me. Apart from having a PhD from Berkeley University, from being a fellow at the Virginia Foundation for Humanities in Charlottesville, and a renowned historian, she is also a New York Times bestselling author. Since contacting Beth, my family has gone on a journey where we have not only learned about our past, but also the importance of justice, equity, and fighting for what you believe is right. I'm entirely grateful to be a part of this journey, and I'm thankful to Beth for telling Daniel and Anna's story. So I'm very honored to present to you all Elizabeth Dowling Taylor."
Thank you. Well, thank you, Gregory. And I now have my next book, and it is the story of your father's side of the family. I'm very pleased to be here. It's nice to see familiar faces and new faces, and I thank Politics and Prose for sponsoring the event tonight. My book is a biography of Daniel Murray, who was appointed an assistant librarian of Congress at a time when such professional appointments for Black men were rare. He was a pioneer in the Black History Movement. He was a major race activist, a model civic citizen, and a prominent member of Washington, D.C.'s Black elite. But the book also tells the story of a larger narrative, and that is the remarkable rise and disastrous decline of African American prospects over Murray's lifetime. 1851, he was born free, 1851 to 1925. The rise of prospects for African Americans following emancipation was, in the words of one ex-slave, a glorious harvest of good things. Perhaps most notably, the 14th and 15th Amendments to the United States Constitution, granting all rights of citizenship, including the vote, to Americans of every color. But after the rise came the backward slide, when the federal government, in the name of reconciliation with the former Confederate states, brought about an abrupt and premature ending to Reconstruction and failed to honor those black rights embedded in the Constitution. As a longtime student of the slavery period, I well knew that understanding it was central to understanding American history. I was slower in my own study of the period between emancipation and the modern civil rights era. And I'd noticed with others that sometimes the word Reconstruction brings about a doubtful look. Was that a good thing or a bad thing? I will tell you a personal anecdote. I had a picture in my head that had been there for a long time of African American senators and congressmen in the legislative chambers, but looking like buffoonish rubes with hayseeds in their mouths. Recently, I rewatched the original 1925 Birth of a Nation. And I say rewatched because I remember that I had watched it in high school, and it was presented in a humanities class, not to discuss the content, but because of the innovative film techniques of D.W. Griffith. Well, as I watched it this time, and of course it's just despicable, I could only watch a small segment at a time, but came to the point where there was a screenshot that was indeed the vision, the picture, in my head. And it showed African Americans in the halls of Congress. One had his feet up on his desk. They were in the foreground of the shot, so they loomed enormous. And his colleague was in the background, and he was chewing on a giant chicken leg. We understand the power of pop culture and visual media in particular. And this propaganda of a movie, most of all, that had such an effect on so many Americans, and not just in that first generation, but in generations to follow. And these kinds of images, when they are not countered by accurate schooling, lead to the kind of picture that I carried around in my head so long. To be sure, there were 23 African-American gentlemen who served in the United States Senate or House of Representatives, and they did so with distinction. So yes, Reconstruction was a good thing, but it ended too early, and it was followed by Jim Crow. African Americans were subject all over again to reoppression. Racism was uglier and more pervasive during the Jim Crow period even than it had been in slavery. Discrimination, segregation, stigmatization, intimidation, and terror. It's important for us to recognize even the shameful chapters in our history so that we can be better informed in considering solutions to deal with inequalities among Americans today. And with this current feeling out there that some Americans are more American than other Americans. Now, in telling my story of rise and reversal, I wanted to personalize the larger narrative by zooming in and kind of couching in the lived experience of one man and his family. And turned out that Daniel Murray was really an apt choice because his life story follows is such a good match for the larger narrative. And I very purposefully focused on the Black elite. And I did that for two reasons. One is to underscore the heterogeneity of the Black experience. Now, there are some that equate the Black community with a monolithic group that lives in the inner city, has never had decent schooling, lives in poverty. This is not a homogeneous group. African Americans are certainly not that now, but they were not almost throughout the entirety of American history, certainly not by the 1840s. There was a group of African Americans who were elite in the sense that they were well-educated, they were prosperous, they were well-to-do, they were accomplished, and they were genteel. They were doctors, they were lawyers, they were businessmen, they were entrepreneurs, and they were office holders in D.C., in district offices or federal offices, oftentimes clerk, oftentimes higher offices. And this was the community that Daniel Murray was part of. He was born in Washington's sister city, Baltimore, in 1851, and he moved to the nation's capital following half-siblings that had moved here before him when he was about 18. One of his half-siblings was a caterer in Washington, and at the time he was proprietor for the Senate restaurant in the United States Capitol. The United States Capitol had two restaurants on the ground floor, one on the House side, one on the Senate side, and they were open to the public. Daniel Murray began working in the Senate restaurant as a waiter, and there he had the opportunity to rub shoulders not only with lawmakers, but also with the Librarian of Congress, because at that time, and until 1897, the library was housed in the Capitol. The current Librarian of Congress was Ainsworth Spofford, and in fact he would serve as librarian all the way from 1864, appointed by Lincoln, until 1897 with the move to the new dedicated building across the street that we now know as the Jefferson Building. So Spofford really took Murray under his wing, and in a short 3 years he got the title of assistant librarian. There were others with this title. I don't mean to imply that he was the only one with that title. Well, there were only eight people, maybe a dozen people total, counting the custodial staff, who worked at the Library of Congress when he was hired there in 1871. He would work there for 52 years. There were well over 500 employees when he retired in 1925. Of course, today I'm delighted to say that the Librarian of Congress is an African American, and well over 3,000 people report to her. That'd be Carla Hayden, of course. So Murray was doing very well in his career, getting steady raises. He also, however, like many in the Black elite, had a second stream of income. And in many cases, it was real estate. And, you know, some of you here tonight who know Washington history, you'll recognize some of these family names, like Cook and Francis and Syfax and Wormley and Brent. These were families that had been free and in Washington for several generations, that had first pickings when it came to what might then have been land out in the country or the suburbs, but which eventually became prime downtown Washington real estate. And Murray, coming right after the Civil War, he too had early pickings. He was not only did he dabble in real estate, but he was an actual building entrepreneur. And he had built, probably over 100 structures in Washington. Some of them were homes for Black elite friends of his. They were all first-class structures. And then some of them were spec houses. Eventually, he built homes for his own family. His wife was Anna Evans Murray. He married in 1879. Now, Anna Evans was from Oberlin, Ohio, the great historically abolitionist town. She went to Oberlin College, and this was before her family moved to Washington. Well, you know, to get into the Black elite, and to be sure this was a very exclusive group, wouldn't be inaccurate to call them a bit of a snobbish group. Now, you had to have a package of qualifications to get in. Most of the people in the Black elite had light complexions. Now, being light-skinned, that wasn't enough. You know, mulatto nobody was the phrase used to indicate that, no, you don't get in for having light skin, and you don't get in for being rich. Not if you're, you know, nouveau riche, you know, as opposed to the most important question, which would be, who are your people? Are you already related to others in the Black elite? Have you been highly educated and maybe come to Washington to assume a government position? Or do you stem from a lineage that includes Civil War heroes or a well-known abolitionist? Bingo on a number of these, but especially the last one for Anna, because she had many important abolitionists and other personages among her relatives, including the first man, the first African-American, who served in either the United States Senate or Congress, and that would be Hiram Revels. And then two of her relatives were young men who had given up their lives at Harper's Ferry, two of John Brown's raiders at Harper's Ferry in 1859. So this was a great match for Anna and Daniel. You know, I do want to emphasize that these were people that followed current events, especially race issues. They were very social people. I mean, if you weren't into the social world, there wasn't much sense in being part of the Black elite, because they were constantly throwing dinners and card parties and balls and entertaining other elites that would come from out of town. Washington was considered the mecca for the Black elite, but there were enclaves, small enclaves of their peers in cities like Cleveland and Chicago and Atlanta and Memphis and New York, Philadelphia, Boston. And they would entertain one another whenever they were visiting. But, you know, at the time, during the rise, Washington was considered the colored man's paradise, you know. And indeed, there had been this illustrious period that had begun, let's talk about the period from 1865 to 1875. Over that 10-year period, 13th, 14th, 15th amendments were passed, and so was a number, and so were various civil rights acts. You know, we think, oh, civil rights acts, that happened in the 1960s. Well, that happened in the 1860s and 70s, and it culminated in the passage in 1875 of the Civil of the Civil Rights Act that guaranteed equal access to all for public facilities, restaurants, bars, hotels, places of entertainment, and so on. And so there really was a period where it was all coming together, and it was a glorious period. Now, I am not saying that prejudice in the nation's capital ever went away entirely, certainly not. But it was trending that way. And when there were still instances of discrimination, they were called out as anomalies. You're bucking the trend here. Get with the program. And Daniel Murray and his wife Anna and others, they were primed to think of themselves as Americans first, people of color, and with no apology for color, second. And it would only be logical then that the next step would be assimilation into mainstream society, that there would be one society. Well, no one could have told then, no one could have foretold that that Civil Rights Act of 1875 would be the last Civil Rights Act passed by the United States Congress for 80 years. As W.E.B. Du Bois later lamented, the slave went free, stood for a brief moment in the sun, then turned back toward slavery. Now, historians will tell you that the end of Reconstruction was the election of 1876. This was a contested election. Of course, blacks were voting. You know, sometimes it seems when we talk about, oh, you know, blacks didn't get the vote, at least, you know, down in the South, until the, you know, 1960s or beyond. Well, the right to vote is embedded in the Constitution. And blacks were coming out to vote in droves. That's how these African Americans got elected to Congress. But, you know, the whites ran scared. And in this contested election, the Democrat, and remember, African Americans are voting Republican. We've had a switcheroo there. This was the party of Lincoln. This was the party, these were the radical Republicans in Congress who had passed all these measures and forced them through. So it seemed like they and the federal government in general was the black man's protector, but no more. So what happened is the Democratic candidate offered up some contested electoral votes in return for the Republican candidate to agree that, yes, he would become president, but one of the first things he would do is to order the remaining federal troops in the South, keeping Reconstruction commitments, to go, that there would be no interference in the South. Now, you know, I don't deny that this was a very tall order. And no matter who was president, even the great Lincoln, what had to be done at some point was to both let the South up easy and to do right by the freedmen. Very hard to pull both of those goals off. And in the end, reconciliation came at the cost of black freedom. Well, this began the period of Jim Crow, and Washington was not left out. The black elite was not left out. Year after year, Washington became more segregated. There was more discrimination in many more ways. Now, I don't think 1876 was the end of Reconstruction. I think it was the beginning of the end. And really, it took much longer for black elites here in Washington to realize that this new trend, this backwards trend, was real, and they were loath to admit it was real, and that there was no flexibility to account for class. As time went by, more and more, all that mattered was the one-drop rule. Blacks in the elite class were not to be considered exceptions, despite their achievements, despite their refinements. And this was a bitter pill for them to swallow. Murray himself had a personal reversal in 1897. Now, I kind of already indicated that there was a removal of the Library of Congress from the United States Capitol to the new dedicated building across the street that had been built over a period of 11 years. Spofford, the librarian, had cried for years already, it's too crowded, and believe me, he never turned down a book. It's too crowded. We need a brand new structure. And it was a long process talking Congress into it, and when it was finally done, it was unbelievable how the books were burgeoning out of their space at the Capitol. And although Spofford had turned all of this into action, in the end, a new Librarian of Congress was appointed, and Spofford had to be contented in taking the chief assistant librarian. Well, what did that mean to Daniel Murray? Well, with the move to the new building, there needed to be a great uptick in number of employees, a whole new organization for the library. And Murray was appointed to be chief of the division of periodicals, the most popular division in the library, and he was thrilled. He got a nice raise with it. He was bragging about it to his friends. Well, as it turned out, he was demoted after only a few months on the job, and that was because Spofford could not hold him in his place because he was no longer the head librarian, and that person undertook a new organization that not only lost Murray his title, not only lost him his raise, but his salary was set back not to what he had been making before the raise, but to the amount he had been making about a decade earlier. He was humiliated. And the problem was, you know, the explanation was friction incident to caste. Well, what that really came down to is if he was a head of a department, he would have underlings, white underlings, and that simply would not do. And very sadly, Murray's contribution to the library, as I'll continue to describe it, was enormous, but he never got another raise over a full quarter of a century of service. Now, the nadir was the period when Woodrow Wilson was president. He was Southern bred, so were a good number of the men on his cabinet, and they came up with this idea that the federal departments, this had never been done, the federal departments should be segregated. And all of a sudden in the Treasury Department and other post office, other places, black employees were set off behind screens, forced to use colored-only toilets, a separate lunch area. And this even went down at the Library of Congress. So one day, Murray goes into work, and he finds out there's a separate cloakroom for black employees. And all of a sudden, in the lunchroom, there's a sequestered area. And now they cannot use the public cafeteria any more than African American visitors to the Library of Congress can. Now, I'm here to say that while it was really hard for the black elite to accept that this was the true reality and that, you know, there was no flexibility in that color line because of their, they kept wanting to put the emphasis on class and on respectability, but that wasn't going to fly. But they didn't just take this slide laying down. They didn't bite their fingernails waiting on white largesse. They fought it. And Daniel Murray and Anna Murray in particular. Now, there's an organization I wanted to tell you about that Daniel Murray was very involved with. And some of you may never have run across it. It was called the National Afro-American Council. It was the first truly national civil rights organization in America. Murray was a member of the first executive committee, and he was also chief of their legal and legislative bureau. Rayford Logan, historian Rayford Logan, has said that the NAAC has never gotten the credit that it deserves as the really proper precursor for the NAACP. Now, I know a lot of you may be thinking, yeah, what about the Niagara Movement? Well, the Niagara Movement was the immediate precursor, but it was very short-lived, never had the membership that the NAAC did. But moreover, whether it be the Niagara Movement or the NAACP, the goals, and especially the techniques that they adopted, were taken from the NAAC. Now, I'm talking about national legislative reform, but most importantly, I'm talking about challenges to the in the court system. Go fight it out in the courts. That was the legacy handed down from the NAAC. They took on lynching. They took on Jim Crow cars. Certainly not all successfully. Certainly not. One of the movers and shakers in the NAAC was George White. He was a congressman who served all the way up until 1901. And he was the first to introduce anti-lynching legislation in Congress. It, you know, died in committee as it died over and over again with every new reintroduction. They also fought through the court system, challenged the court system on the issue of the denial of voting rights in the South. Now, what the Southern states did, they came up with new state constitutions that maneuvered around the 15th Amendment, undercutting the intent of the 15th Amendment. So, for example, what they did in Louisiana, they set a requirement for voting, and that was acceptable at the time. There was a literacy requirement, but at the same time, they added what they called a grandfather's clause, which said that if your ancestors could vote by the time the Civil War ended, then you were excluded from the requirement. You were grandfathered out from the requirement. And of course, that was as good as saying rare would be the African Americans who would be allowed to vote. And as you well know, even if the legality of the situation was in their favor, they were intimidated from voting. And, you know, one of the techniques that the white supremacists in the South use that I really want to underscore, because I think there's a parallel today, is this fear of what they would call Negro domination. The whites in power tried to scare the white rank and file by saying, if we don't get the black man under our thumb again, then what you're going to be looking at is that blacks are going to take over and they're going to be the ones, they're going to have the white people under their thumbs, and they're going to be dominating every aspect of our life, not only at the political level, but at the social level and at the sexual level, you know, and so on and so forth. And I want to push that, because I think that we're living in a time of fear-mongering. You know, in our particular case, it has to do with what I would consider this hyped up fear of terrorism, and especially the idea of equating people who follow the Muslim faith with terrorists. And I think we have to be very careful not to buy into that. Now, yeah, that was Murray at the political level, but the main route that he took in terms of black protest was equating scholarship, describing and thinking of scholarship as a form of protest. ignorance, I mean, prejudice, he said, is the handmaiden of ignorance. So he started out at the Library of Congress putting together a bibliography of works by black authors. 270 he started with. Well, it turned out that this was just the beginning of what was his life's work, a project that he followed not only with a passion but with an obsession. He did have some library time to work on it, but mostly he worked on it on his own time. And it just mushroomed from a bibliography of 270. Eventually, when he died, he had a bibliography of 7,500. But he had expanded from Afro-Americans to Afro-Europeans, and from literature to all the polite arts, and from the polite arts to all areas of endeavor, and to all people of the colored race, to use his expression, Africans and people of African descent throughout the world. And he had not, you know, early on, he had expanded from not only bibliography, but biography. And by the time, you know, he was well along in this project, he had a mountain of 25,000 sketches of African, of people of color that, and many of them were obscure. This would be the first insight to many of them. But he was determined to uncover and claim for the Negro race every success story, and very, very much into this idea that he wanted to seek out mixed race people that were high achievers and who were mixed race people, though they were commonly thought to be white. And in some cases, he literally outed people who had been hiding their black ancestry. He said he took some delight in doing this. But the sad part of this was his life's work, this was his obsession, but he never was able to find a publisher who was willing to underwrite such a project, Encyclopedia Africana. And it wasn't until the last year of the 20th century that there was success for such an encyclopedia. You know, W.E.B. Du Bois tried to do it, couldn't pull it off. And the same thing with Carter Woodson. Now, Anna, and I didn't know this at the beginning, but Anna was a great race activist. Now, Murray said, "The true test of the progress of a people is to be found in their literature." Anna said, "It is the home which indicates the substantial progress of any race." And they worked side by side. He was very supportive of her activism. And so her thing was early childhood intervention, kindergartens. And some of you may know that she is indeed the mother of public kindergartens in Washington, D.C., both for black children and for white children. She was the one who went before Congress, and she is the one that finally talked them into appropriating funds for kindergartens as part of the public school system in Washington. So, of course, the black elite were very careful about how they raised their children, and they were very cultivated and exposed to this kind of socializing, special summer retreats, and so on. But Anna's idea was that this would be the early childhood intervention would be the saving grace for the black masses, that if you didn't have that kind of proper home life, the next best thing would be kindergartens. So she became a notable race speaker. She traveled throughout the country presenting her ideas on kindergarten as one of the solution to the race problems. So I want to talk now a little bit about the next generation. You know, part of the American dream is that we like to see our children do better than we did. And you know Murray and the other black elites, they thought they were headed that way, and then they weren't. The Murray sons went to colleges like Harvard and Cornell. And the generations that followed found that there was more discrimination later than there had been earlier. And all of a sudden it was a problem to have different races in the dorm or different races on the sports team and all. So despite these first-rate educations, these sons would come back to Washington and find that their range of job opportunities was was very, very slim. And that's one reason. And, you know, there's a certain irony today in saying, and a lot of people don't realize this, how excellent the colored schools, black colored public school system was in Washington, D.C. It was top rate, better than the white schools through all the grades and especially at the high school level. Well, part of the reason why is that that was one of the few opportunities for these highly educated African Americans. They'd come back from these top colleges and also historically black colleges like Howard and Fisk and so on, and even PhDs, you know, teaching in the grade schools and in the high schools of Washington, D.C. And that was indeed the future of a couple of the Murray sons. The son who succeeded in a business sense by far was Harold, and he needed to move to another country, namely Mexico, to find that kind of success. I know some of you that know Washington history will be familiar with Lillian Evans Tibbs. That was the niece of Anna, and that you may know her as Madame Ivante, a renowned opera singer. Well, she, as I say, was Anna's niece, and she found greater success in Europe than she did in her home country. Her lifelong goal was to sing with the Metropolitan Opera Company in New York, but that never happened because of her color. So, you know, it was a long, torturous climb back up. What Murray thought, this kind of merit-based recognition that Murray thought was just around the corner a full century earlier, did not begin to be approached until the 1970s. You know, I think most people hold dear American ideals, equality under the law, religious freedom, individual rights. I think that the only way that we can redeem ourselves as a nation for shameful chapters in our past is to be sure to honor these rights in the future, even in times of hyped up fear. We debate today individual rights versus security, and we have to be very careful how much of the latter we're willing to give up in order to fortify the former. So I would suggest that this is indeed a cautionary tale. And one of the mistakes that you don't want to make is waiting too long. Rights won must be rights guarded, and if necessary, re-won. So I'm going to end it there. Thank you very much. We're going to have a few questions, but I, Heidi, would you did you have an announcement that you'd like to make?
Oh, sure, yes. We're delighted, actually. Elizabeth's publisher, HarperCollins, is providing a reception in the coffee shop downstairs afterwards. So she's going to take your questions, as she said, and then books are available for sale at the register. She'll sign books up here, and then please come downstairs into the coffee shop for wine and cheese, compliments of HarperCollins.
So you see, even though we're asking you to fold your own chair, we're going to give you a glass of wine in return. Dr. Harris.
Yes, Bob Harris, Professor Emeritus, Cornell University. I want to thank you publicly for the prodigious research that you've done in producing this book and uncovering a part of African-American history that in many respects has been buried, as well as showing that the black population was not monolithic. Now, you mentioned my question. You mentioned Henry Louis Gates and Kwame Anthony Appiah and their Encyclopedia Africana.
I refer to it, but thank you for spelling out their names.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, as great a work as it is, I think the work that Murray had done still needs to be published. Has anyone approached you?
No. And I must say that Murray needed the hand of a strong editor. It's just true. He has mountains of material, but he needed the hand of a strong editor to both organize it and to improve it. So if I was approached, I'd turn that job down. But but maybe someday someone will do it, because the bulk of there's no question in my mind that there is probably data in his material that is unknown to us now. And so it would be a job well done. How about you, Dr. Harris? Maybe somebody else. Yes, sir.
I'm halfway through your beautiful and intensely interesting book, and I do have a question for you, but I just would like to say, you said at the end of your talk about the importance of honoring the rights that every American is supposed to have. And I agree with what you said, but Herodotus said that the purpose of history is to give great men their due meed of praise. And I would like to thank you for honoring and telling the story of a great man who had been forgotten.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate that. Daniel Murray's descendants appreciate it. And Daniel Murray would appreciate hearing those words. Thank you. Thank you.
But my question for you is, in the last few years, we've read about the effect that Woodrow Wilson had on segregating government service and, in general, his racial attitudes. I wonder whether the Republican presidents who followed Wilson, Harding and Coolidge and Hoover, did anything to undo any of the segregation that took place under Wilson's administration.
Well, thank you for your question. And I guess what I'm happy to...
I have one more. I really want to know what you say, but if I understood the man who introduced you correctly, Daniel Murray's granddaughter is in here, and I wonder, after you answered that question, if she would be willing to say anything about her own memories of her grandfather, if she knew him, and what the family
question.
Memories of...
Well, okay, well, Carmen, would you be willing to do that? Come to the mic here. I hope it's okay for me to say that we were privileged today, the family and I, to visit Daniel Murray's home in Northwest Washington. It is expanded, and Carmen, as a girl, was visited there several times, including when she was 15, and had her
quinceañera.
And so when we went there today, you know that it brought back a lot of memories for her.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you for being here tonight. I didn't know my grandfather because he died in 1925, and I was still an angel in heaven. But I could tell you that I knew him through my father, through all the education he gave us, all the advices. And I think that our family has the honesty that he, through my father, gave us, and especially the dignity of being a human being. And I think that is a heritage very, very important in our family. And I think I have been able to educate my two girls in that path, in that way. To be honest person, to accept everything in the world, to be open-minded, not to be prejudiced against anything like religion, like nationality, like color of the skin. We all were created equally, And what really is important in a person is what this person has inside, in the heart and in the mind. I think that's the real power that the human being has, his heart and his mind.
So much, and thanks to our attendee who suggested that. That was beautiful. And I will answer his question. Here's the good news about what happened under the Woodrow Wilson administration. That kind of segregation and discrimination went on, but the NAACP was right there, and white and black voices were speaking up. And the good news is that none of that ever got codified by law. So it isn't as if the presidents that followed had to come in and turn that around. On the other hand, I don't know the histories of those three presidents real well, but nothing came right to mind as far as them, you know, trying to reverse again the prospects of African Americans. As I say, once this slide happened, it was decade after decade of segregation, you know, by, you know, de jure in the South, de facto in the North. It was a long slog to get back up. Sir?
Sometimes I like to switch. If there's somebody over there, that, because somebody spoke. Sure. Go ahead.
I'll be glad. All right, I have a couple of questions. One is for you and one is for the descendants. You talk about the slide that occurred among African Americans, but I'm wondering if you've done any research on how some black folks survived by intermarrying and ending up with families like this. You know, and it was more common than I think we know of. That's one question. And the other question is, I'm just wondering why you use the term elite. And I know that's not a term that you coined, but the lines were often blurred because, like in every community where there was a historically black college or university, there was a group of so-called, I hate to use the word elite, educated people, upwardly mobile people, achievers, and so on. And the color range and the abilities and the attitudes varied. I mean, the best example is Booker T. Washington. People rarely consider him elite because he advocated for the masses, but he traveled the world, met with, you know, leaders of European countries and so on. So those are the two main questions.
You know, there's no doubt that what you're saying about educated people and people, you know, involved in current events and all, it does get hazy there. On the other hand, the people that were in the black elite, let's just say in Washington, D.C., they knew the other people in the black elite. These were very, and there wasn't just one black elite. There were cliques, and the cliques could change over time, either because some of these elites, you know, came to Washington for a particular position, were here for 5 years, and then went back to their home city, or, you know, just because of jostling and competing among themselves, or, you know, today this is a good buddy who's part of your group, and then, you know, 2 years later he's in another clique. So it really, they really were snobbish about it. And if you didn't, you know, if for the most part, if you couldn't be part of their lifestyle, and it took a lot of money to participate at this level in throwing balls and having gowns and having tuxedos and entertaining in the home and getting a caterer in the home, then you just weren't going to survive in that group. It was very competitive. So I understand what you're saying, but as far as the elites in the cities themselves, they were very aware of who was in and who was out.
Okay, and then the other part of the question, have you done research, aside from the fact that you clearly know the descendants, yeah, of Daniel Murray,
mm-hmm,
have you done research on how people, black folks, survived into the 20th century.
Again,
by intermarrying.
What I know about that color question is that black elites were very color conscious, and you could see that in their choice of mates alone. Light-skinned black elites married other light-skinned black elites. So obviously, there's all kinds of race mixing going on there. Very many of the black elites were so light-skinned they could pass for white. Now, those that wanted to be part of the black elite and were proud to be part of the black elite, they didn't want to pass for white. One of Murray's friends said, you know, he's very light-skinned. He said, all my life I've been trying to pass for colored. No. On the other hand, with the next generation, there were members of, you know, the Wall family, the Syfax family, the Greener family, and lots of other well-known names among the black elite where they had offspring that melded into the white population. Now, in the case of Harold, his first wife was African-American, and indeed, she was the sister-in-law of Walter F. White, who was the executive secretary of the NAACP for so long and a luminary in the Harlem Renaissance. So he got his job opportunity in Mexico. He and his first wife had 6 children, but after they divorced, she and the children stayed in Mexico because that's where their father was. That's where they had made their home. And then for his second wife, Harold took a Mexican national, a woman named Olympia Lasso. So I don't think that when he married his second wife, he was thinking about marrying out of the race. I just think that now this was his home was in Mexico, and he fell in love with a Mexican woman. So more generally than that, I really, you know, couldn't say. They fell in love. It happens. Thank you.
Yes. Could you please, I thought I understood until the question was asked, where the Daniel Murray collection is? I think I know.
Oh, no. Good question, because I haven't addressed it.
How broad is it?
Yeah.
Bibliography.
Well, oh, thank you very much. Now, all of the work, not just the bibliography, but all of the biographies, and the other material, it is today only available on 27 reels of microfilm. You can get it at the Library of Congress. The original microfilm is at the Wisconsin Historical Society. So there's just a few copies of even the microfilm spread throughout the country, maybe, you know, not more than 5 copies, let's say. What happened is that when Daniel could never find a publisher, his widow could never find a publisher, his son could never find a publisher, and so Harold, who was the last living son, once his brother died in the house in Northwest Washington in 1965, he empties out the house. Out from its cubbyhole comes all of this life's work, and he tries to donate it to the Library of Congress. No doubt they highly regret today that they passed. And then Harold became aware of one of the directors at the Wisconsin Historical Society. They were putting together a collection of civil rights manuscripts. And Harold was told that this would be a good home for these materials. And that's where they went. But they were in fragile condition, and in a decision that they probably regret, they microfilmed it all but then destroyed the originals. So that's another thing, Dr. Harris, whoever would undertake to produce that now, they'd be working, you know, strictly with a microfilm. Yeah.
How many reels did you say?
27 reels.
27?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
All right, we'll take one more question.
Okay. Following up on that question, I worked at the Library of Congress, and I actually cataloged by handwriting many of the surviving items that Daniel Murray had collected over his career.
Books.
Yeah, books mm-hmm. and pamphlets, among which were some dummy copies of his encyclopedia that were maybe 3 pages of type, and all the rest were blank. My question, though, is what brought you to Daniel Mary as the personification of your larger.
Well, now I can acknowledge my Paul Jennings descendants here, because my first book was about Paul Jennings, who was James Madison's enslaved manservant. And I did a lot of work researching him in the various research institutions in the city, including the Library of Congress. And there, with Daniel Mary putting all these biographies together, and one of the notable early African-American leaders among the free black community here in Washington, once he wasn't a slave anymore, was Paul Jennings. And he had written up his story, he had interviewed his son, who was still living, and so a lot of what was really important intelligence for me, I got from Murray's work. Not only that, but the memoir that Paul Jennings wrote, considered by the White House to be the first memoir of life behind the scenes in the executive mansion, period, there were precious few copies of it. And it was on that original list that Murray constructed. And I firmly believe that he saved it from total obscurity, since there were so few copies of it. But that's when I first heard of who is Daniel Murray and became interested in Murray's own story. Gregory, would you like to make a remark?
I would like to ask a question, actually.
All right.
Just based on the whole, especially political situation going on right now, and how there tends to be a lot of racial tension within the country once again. I know I've read an article from, do you, any of you know Samantha Bee?
Yeah. Sure we do. Oh.
Very funny, I like her a lot. One of her assistants went to the Republican National Convention, and she was of color. And then she said that the people, they'd said some of the most kindly racist things while putting their arms around her. So, I find that interesting, because I think the sad thing is a lot of these people, they don't know what they're doing is actually harmful or insensitive, and it stems from ignorance. So I'm just wondering why you think this history was lost to people, and what do you think can be done? This book is a good first step to kind of reclaim that history, to tell people that this actually happened, and it's not just a hopeless case.
Well,
and
one thing I, one thing I, one reason I think it was lost is because we're so ashamed of it. I mean, we like to think there's a master American narrative, and that even if slowly, it's always moving towards increasing freedoms. And, you know, here was a case where there was an utter reversal. So that master narrative is not unidirectional. And it can change course at any time again. But I think this was the biggest single reversal in our nation's history. Not only, the ironies, it was stated clearly in the United States Constitution. Blacks have every right of citizenship, including the vote, but that was denied. On top of that, we like to think of ourselves first and foremost as a nation of laws. And yet breaking the law, atrocities as extreme as arson and lynching, were ignored. No redress to the law, whether it be the local law, and then you turn to the federal government and say, well, certainly you'll help me. You're not going to allow lynchings to go on, in America, are you? But they did. They turned a blind eye to it. So I think that the reason it doesn't get the attention it deserves is because we're ashamed of it. But we have to own it. I hate to end on such a sad note, but we're going to have to do just that. So thank you very much.